So good morning, everybody. So let's start. So many of you have joined in. So today we are going to take up a very, very important chapter for you in calculus. In fact, this is the heaviest of all the calculus chapters that will come across in class 12th. And before I begin with, let me tell you, this chapter requires a lot of practice. And there are different types of questions asked under this chapter, and for each type there is a different algorithm. So this requires all the more practice of at least 15-20 questions of every type. So right now, when we all have the summer vacation running on, this is a good chapter to begin with because you'll get ample time to practice, and you'll realize that every problem has a different approach. I mean, you have to think laterally to solve a question. Moreover, in this chapter, you would require that you have to be a very good observer, right? You may have seen a differentiation chapter earlier. It was very conventional. You had some set of methods, set of rules, which you apply and you get your answer. But this chapter is exactly opposite of that chapter, okay? Not only in terms of the process, but also in terms of it being unconventional. That means you have to think laterally. You have to think out of the box. Okay, sometimes an approach may not click. Okay, you have to go and change your approach and come back again at the problem. So when I was preparing this chapter in my class 12th, I almost practiced this chapter for 1.5 months. Okay, and I did more than 1,000+ problems to get confidence. Till date also, this chapter surprises most of the students, even if they have practiced a lot, because different varieties of questions are formed every year. Okay, so the prerequisite of this chapter is only the concept of your basic differentiation. You don't have to know much. So I'll be giving you the overview of this chapter. So let me just give you an overview of entire calculus actually. So in calculus, what all do you have? Okay, of course, in the integration part, we'll talk about. Overview of integration. So under integration, you'll be studying two types of integration. One is called indefinite integrals. Indefinite integrals or indefinite integration. Okay. This is going to be just the raw integration. You are going to learn the process over here. Okay. And the process is basically the process of doing antiderivative. So we'll talk about it in the subsequent part of today's course. So here you are learning the process. Here you are learning to get the area function. What is area function and all? We'll talk about that. Okay. This has got various types. If I recall properly, there are more than 20 types of integrals that you'll be coming across. Okay. And I was telling the others before most of you joined in that this may take almost three and a half classes. So nearly about 12 to 15 hours will go in indefinite integrals, because this process involves so many types of integration. Then you'll have definite integrals. Then you have definite integrals. In definite integrals, you'll be basically using lot of properties, right? It is primarily to do with the properties of graphs, okay? Because under definite integrals, you're learning how to find the area under a function, okay? And it will be mostly governed by properties. You can say indefinite integral will only play 10-15% role in this. Okay, mostly it will be governed by properties. So there are more than 14 properties which will be told. And this is the favorite of JEE. Okay, so JEE main, you will get more questions on definite integrals rather than on indefinite integrals. But however, you need to know both the processes. Why definite integral questions are asked a lot? Because it can be asked in the form of area under curves, okay, which is going to be the next topic, which is called application of integrals. Application of integration. Under the application, you are going to just study one application, okay? Area under the curves. And in few instances, we'll be also talking about how to find the Riemann sum. Riemann sum. Okay, that is called evaluating limit of a sum by use of definite integrals. So evaluating limit of a sum by use of using definite integrals. Is that fine? Any questions so far? No, there will be no solids of revolution. There will be no finding the length of arc and all in your application of integration. But however, if you are a student of AP calculus, you need to study all those things. Okay, washer method and disk method and all those things that is there. There's no application of integration in kinematics also. Okay. So CBSE curriculum, also as to say JEE curriculum, is very dry when it comes to application of integrals. And finally, there is a chapter which is, you can say, a summarizing chapter for all the concepts you have learned, which is solving of differential equations. Okay, so this chapter will use the concept of integration, differentiation, everything that you have learned, okay, in the previous three chapters, to solve equations which are made in differential coefficients. That is what we call as differential equations. So we'll be learning how to solve first order differential equation primarily. But however, for people who are preparing for JEE Advanced, I'll give you an idea how to solve higher order differential equations also. Okay. So as you can see, all these equations are linked, all these chapters are linked to integration. So integration becomes a very integral part of your calculus. Okay. So it's good that you are starting this chapter in the summers. You'll get enough time to practice. Okay, so you know, take a deep plunge in integration. It is addictive also sometimes. Many a times you'll feel like, you know, doing integration every time, right? Because if it challenges your gray cells, you'll feel that it is addictive. So this is the overview of integration. Any question here? So I've told you about the content. I've told you about the time period. Okay, DPPs have already been shared. So get started from today itself. So we'll start with indefinite integrals and we'll first talk about why the name indefinite integral was at all given to it. Okay, let me begin with a simple question to all of you. If I say there is a curve, okay, whose dy by dx or the derivative of that curve with respect to x is 2x, then what is the curve? Then what is the curve?
2x square plus c.
2x square plus c. There's a curve whose derivative is 2x. What could be the curve?
So y is x square.
Y is equal to x square. Very good. Now, who was that?
Sir Anurag.
Anurag said y equal to x square. Let's say somebody else, let's say Aditi says, why only y equal to x square? It could be y is equal to x square plus 1 also, right? Right. This could also be a curve whose derivative will give you 2x. Somebody else will say, why x square plus 1? It could be x square plus 2 also, right? Somebody could say, why x square plus 2? It could be y is equal to x square minus 1 also. So what I'm trying to say here is that there is a family of curves. Basically, if you go, you can do anything like this and still get the same answer. So your curve is, if your curve is y is equal to x square plus c, where c is some arbitrary constant. Okay, arbitrary constant, sometimes also called as the constant of integration. Sometimes also called the constant of integration. So if you take any of these, you know, curves, its derivative is going to still give you 2x. So what I'm trying to say here is that there is no definite answer. There is no definite answer as to what is that curve whose derivative gave you 2x. So it gives you a family of curves, right? Why I'm calling it as family of curves? Because if you vary this, you keep getting different family members satisfying the same, right? So now these kind of curves will satisfy this particular equation. Now, boys and girls, I would like to highlight you here. You are actually seeing a differential equation in front of you. This is what we call as an ordinary differential equation. By the way, we are only going to talk about ordinary differential equation throughout our course of study in class 12. There's something called partial differential equation and all, which is not in the purview of our study. Okay, that you'll study in undergraduate. Okay. So what you see here is actually a first order ordinary differential equation. So integration is a process by which you find solutions to differential equation, right? So in some time you learn how to integrate 2x, correct? I'm sure most of you already know how to do this. It's just connecting the dots kind of a thing. When you're integrating 2x, my dear, you are actually solving this. You're solving a first order differential equation. Okay, so you have already started solving differential equations. So remember, it was our fourth chapter of our discussion, but you have already started with it right in this very chapter. So when you are finding all these curves which satisfy this differential equation, you are actually finding its general solution. Okay, so integration is a process. I'll repeat. Integration is a process by which you are finding general solutions to ordinary differential equation. Okay. And your differential equation, in this case, when you're performing integration only once, okay, it is a first order differential equation. Now, what is the example of a second order differential equation? I'm sure you would have come across this equation in your life. Where have you come across this equation in your life?
SHM.
SHM is an example of a second order differential equation. This is a second order differential equation. And you would realize that the order decides how many arbitrary constants should be there in the solution or in the general solution. So if this is a second order, it will have two arbitrary constants, right? Remember, you used to write it like this: A cos t, B sin t. Okay, so A and B will be two arbitrary constants because it's a second order differential equation. However, I'm not going to talk about this as of now, because anyways, I'm going to spend a considerable amount of time on this in the differential equation chapter. But just to tell you why there is one arbitrary constant is because you are solving a first order differential equation. Okay, you are solving a first order DE. Okay. So now it is clear why the name indefinite was given, because there is no definite answer. It is going to give you a family of curves satisfying it. Now, in case of definite integral, you are actually dealing with area. Okay, it's not that you're not dealing with area here. This is actually an area function. Okay, so this function will be called as an area function. Okay, as it will be helpful for people who are doing APs. They call it as the area function and all. Okay. So what is integration in a layman language? It is a accumulative calculus process, right? Now we are no more into differential calculus process. We are into accumulative calculus process, where we are trying to find out the area function from the idea of the slope of the tangent at every point of the curve. Should I repeat it again? So integration is a accumulative calculus, or it is a part of an accumulative calculus, where we are trying to get the area function from the idea of the slope of the tangent at every point on the curve. Okay, so you're going to construct back the function whose derivative is this. Okay, by the way, something very important that you must all know as a nomenclature also, when you differentiate something, let's say if you differentiate a function g, okay, it gives you f. Okay, then we say f of x is the derivative of g of x with respect to x. So you must be thinking, what is big in this? We already know this. Okay, but when you integrate f of x, okay, to get this g of x plus c, then we call g of x, in fact, you can include c also, g of x plus c is the primitive of f of x. Is the primitive of f of x. Okay. So this term primitive is a new term to you. Don't be scared if the question reads find the primitive of this. So don't be surprised. Okay. Primitive just means finding the integral. Okay. So g of x, which we call as the integral, you can also call it as the primitive. Okay. And the function that you are normally integrating, that is called the integrand. Okay, just know these terms because, you know, while speaking to people, you might need to use these terminologies. Fine. So a simple example is the coffee beans are the primitive of coffee, the coffee that you have in the morning. Okay. So coffee beans is basically the primitive of the cup of coffee. So coffee is the derivative of the coffee beans. So this is the primitive of the coffee. So if you differentiate it, you get a coffee. If you integrate this back, you end up getting the coffee beans. Okay. Just a simple, you know, analogy to explain you that. Now, as I told you, integration is a process, and this process is antiderivative. Okay, that's why we sometimes call antidifferentiation or finding the antiderivative. Now, by the virtue of the fact that integration is antidifferentiation or antidifferentiation, depending upon which pronunciation you choose, we are going to now derive the integral of some standard function, some basic standard function. Okay, just like we had done this exercise in the differentiation, differentiating constant, differentiating x, the power rule, then differentiating cos x, sin x, tan x, etc. So we'll do some integration of some basic functions by the virtue that we know it's anti-differentiation. So let's go back to our differentiation. We have learned that if you differentiate any constant, you get a zero, right? It means integral of zero with respect to x. Now, this is how you need to write. This is a symbol which is a stretched version of S. So if you stretch S, it becomes this. Okay. S stands for sum, because integration is a process of summing up continuously changing quantities. This symbol was given to us by Gottfried Leibniz. Okay, given to us by Leibniz. Okay, Leibniz, as you know, he was a co-inventor of calculus, independently of Newton. Newton was working on differential calculus. Leibniz was working on integral calculus. So integral of zero with respect to x, that is what we write, integral zero dx. Please note, my dear students, I'm telling you right now here, this is a mistake which 90% of you will make. You will forget to write dx most of the time. If you do that, the symbol, this is, makes no sense to me. Okay. So if you don't mention the variable with respect to which you are integrating, then merely writing this makes no sense to me. And if you miss it out, let me tell you, you will definitely lose half a marks for every miss you make while solving integration question. Even board will deduct marks. So two things while doing integration problem: never miss out dx, never miss out putting a c at the end. So integration of, you know, zero is going to just give you a constant. Next, just recalling all our formula back. Differentiation of x was 1. So integration of 1 would be x plus c. Don't forget this c. Okay. Derivative of x square by 2 with respect to x. It was x. So integral of x dx will be x square by 2. If you continue this process, differentiation of x to the power n plus 1 by n plus 1 is x to the power n. It means integration of x to the power n with respect to x will be x to the power n plus 1 by n plus 1 plus c. But provided your n should not be minus 1. So this formula will not work when your n is minus 1. Okay. So for integrating 1 by x, we have a different rule altogether. So integral of 1 by x. Now try to recall whose derivative gave you 1 by x.
Ln x.
Absolutely. So derivative of ln x means log x to the base e, gave me 1 by x. So integral of 1 by x with respect to x will give you ln mod x plus c. Now why do we put a mod? Is because we don't want any negative value of x to come in, because log always accepts a positive argument. Okay. These formulas which I am giving you out of this formula is very important. This is called the power rule of integration. This is called the power rule of integration. Okay. So please remember this. Okay. Very, very important. Moving on. Any questions so far?
No.
Any questions? Okay. Now, let's talk about some trigonometric functions. We know that the derivative of sine of x is given as cos of x. So this implies integral of cos x with respect to x is sine x plus c. Okay. Derivative of negative cos x. What is it? Sine x. So integral of sine x would be negative cos of x. So we are getting to this formula just by the virtue that we know what are their derivatives. In the same way, derivative of tan of x was secant square x. So I'll be going slightly faster over here because it is just a repetition of your class 11th differentiation formula. So it will be tan x plus c. Okay. See, many a times, let me tell you, I'll tell you when the time comes. Just let me complete this. The derivative of secant x, what is that? Secx tan x. So integral of secx tan x is going to be secx plus c. Okay. What is the derivative of minus cosec x? Cosec x cot x. So we say integral of cosec x cot x with respect to x is minus cosec x plus c. See, nowhere I am missing out a dx, nowhere I am missing out the c, that is the constant of integration. So while you are practicing, make sure you are, you know, conscious about them. Okay, what is the derivative of minus of cot x? Cosecant square x. Okay, so integral of cosecant square x with respect to x is going to be minus cot x plus c. Is that fine? Any questions here? Okay. Apart from that, we'll also talk about the exponential functions. Okay, now you must be wondering, if you see this list. In this list, I have nowhere mentioned the integral of tan x. Okay. The reason being, I don't know any function whose derivative gives you tan x. In fact, it is not very commonly used function. Neither I have given you integration of cot x here. Neither I have given you integration of sec x here. Neither I have given you integration of cosec x here. So two direct trigonometric, basic trigonometric function that I have talked about is only sine and cosine. There's no tan, no cot, no sec, no cosec. Right? That doesn't mean their derivative doesn't exist. We'll talk about it when time comes. Okay. So we'll take all those things. Don't worry. So now we are going to talk about derivative of exponential functions. So we all know if you differentiate a to the power x by ln a, it gives you a to the power x. Correct? Okay. Oh my God. It's constrained with the space. So integration of a to the power x with respect to x will give you a to the power x by ln a plus c. Okay. A special case of this is e to the power x. So if you put your a as e, it becomes e to the power x by ln e, which is 1. So nothing changes with respect to e to the power x. So e to the power x is a function which on differentiation or on integration gives you e to the power x. Okay, so this function is unperturbed by integration or differentiation. Okay. Apart from this, you must have learned about the derivative of inverse trig functions, right? Haven't you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what is the derivative of sine inverse 1 by x?
1 by root 1 minus x square.
Yeah, sorry. What is it?
1 by root 1 minus x
square. 1 by root 1 minus x square. Very good. Okay. So we say integral of 1 by under root of 1 minus x square is sine inverse x plus c. Okay. And don't be surprised if you solve an integration problem and go back and check the result and you see that instead of sine inverse x plus c, the answer given is minus cos inverse x plus c. Okay. So don't get surprised here. It's because many a times they will work with trigonometric identities to give the answer in a different form. So later on, we learn that sine inverse x plus cos inverse x is pi by 2. So the term sine inverse x could be written as pi by 2 minus cos inverse x. Correct? So when you add a c to this, that means you add a c to this. Guys, just give me a second. Yeah. So when you add a constant of integration, please note that pi by 2 plus c will be called as another constant of integration, right? So the same result that you had got could also be written as this. See, constant plus another constant is another arbitrary constant. Okay, so don't be surprised if you see the result to be minus of cos inverse x plus c. Many a times you would realize that when you see the answer, it is very different from what you have got. It is not because your result is wrong. It is because they may have started with a different approach. And ultimately, if you simplify your answer and their answer, you will end up getting a similar expression, only differing in constants. Getting my point. So don't start doubting yourself. Oh my God, what has happened? It has gone wrong and all. Okay. Nothing has gone wrong. It's just that they have taken a different approach or probably they have simplified it to a different form. Okay. Now, many people ask me, sir, in board exams, what if they have the different form and we have done it in a different form? Don't worry about it. They have all the different types of the answers that can possibly arise from that question. Okay. So continuing with this list, I think I've got slightly muddled up over here, but okay, let me go to the next slide. Yeah, derivative of tan inverse x, what is it?
1 by 1 plus x.
Very good. 1 by 1 plus x square. So we say integral of 1 by 1 plus x square with respect to x is going to be tan inverse of x plus c. Fine. I'm not talking about cos inverse x, because you know how cos inverse and sine inverse are related, so you can talk about their formula. Similarly, I'm not going to talk about cot inverse x, because cot inverse x, people who don't know this, cot inverse x and tan inverse x are again related by this relation. Okay, for all x belonging to real numbers. Don't worry, I'll talk about this in the chapter ITF. What is ITF? Yeah, very good. Inverse trigonometric functions. Okay, next is the derivative of sec inverse x. What is sec inverse x derivative?
1 by mod x minus 1.
Yeah, 1 by mod x, this. But I'll just write it like that without a mod. So integral of this is going to be... Now, this is one of the most deceptive integrals. Many a times... A term like this will appear and we are clueless. We are applying all our algorithms that we know. So we fail to appreciate that this is a direct integral. The direct integral of this is sec inverse x. So there will be a question in today's session okay, which will be based on this. Okay. Apart from that, just for your information, it is nothing to do with your JE or your school level. This is an optional thing that you should know. Okay. How many of you are introduced to hyperbolic functions? Okay, so I'll introduce you to some hyperbolic functions and their derivatives, etc. And their integrals, etc. So there is something called sine hyperbolic x. Okay, it is pronounced as shine, not sine, shine. Okay, and this is basically e to the power x minus e to the power minus x by 2. Okay, there is another hyperbolic function, cosh. Okay, cos hyperbolic x, which is given by this formula. Okay, where e is your Euler's constant. Now, why they are called hyperbolic function is because they satisfy this identity. They satisfy this identity. Okay. Now people will ask why they were given cos and sine terms, because it resembles very much like your trigonometric identity or that Pythagorean identity, cos square x plus sine square x equal to 1. The only difference is there is a minus here. Okay. Now if you see, it basically fits into the equation of a rectangular hyperbola. That's why it gets its name as hyperbolic functions. Okay. Now this is shine. Cosh, and then there is dan. Okay, dan x. Okay, tan x. If you put an h, it becomes dan x. Okay, dan x is nothing but shine by cosh. So it becomes e to the power x minus e to the power minus x by e to the power x plus e to the power minus x. Okay, the last class you did limits with me, right? Okay. Tell me what happens if I take limit of than as x tends to plus infinity. Okay. And limit of than as x tends to minus infinity. Passed. I'm testing you on your concept of limits. Okay. You did this last class with me. Tell me what is the limit of than as x tends to infinity. And what is the limit of than when x tends to minus infinity. Is it so difficult? Okay. So Aditya is saying that as x tends to infinity, it is going to be 1. Okay. Is he correct? Is Aditya correct?
Yes.
Okay. And as x tends to minus infinity, Pratham tells me that it's minus 1. Okay. Yes. Of course, both of you are correct. By the way, if you're doubtful how it comes, so when you're evaluating the limit as x tends to infinity, okay. Remember, we take e to the power x common, something like this, because it is right now in the infinity by infinity form. Okay, cancel this out. As x tends to infinity, these two gentlemen will go to zero. So as a result, your answer will be 1. That means this graph will die on y equal to 1 line. So y equal to 1 is asymptotic to this. Okay. And if I take the limit as x tends to minus infinity, okay, then basically what do we do is, minus infinity I have to write. Okay, then what do we do is, you take e to the power minus x common, correct? So it is e to the power 2x minus 1 by e to the power 2x plus 1. So now as x tends to minus infinity, e to the power 2x will become 0, so it will give you minus 1 by 1, which is minus 1. So y equal to minus 1 is also asymptote to these graphs. Let me show these graphs to you if you have not seen them before. So on your GeoGebra, there is a ready-made function. The moment you type sine, it will show you sine hx. Okay, put an x. This is the graph of sine, very much like the graph of x cube. Okay, cosh. Okay, this structure is called a catenary. It is basically the structure taken by your necklace when you are wearing it around your neck. Okay, this is the structure taken by your necklace. Or you can say it is the structure taken by any wire of uniform mass per unit length hung between two points whose length is lesser than the, or whose distance is lesser than the length of the wire. So if you see that wires of electric wires and all hanging around, that will be in the shape of a catenary. Okay, showing you now Dan. Okay, so Dan, as we had discussed, y equal to 1 and y equal to minus 1 will be like asymptote. Okay, as you can see, it is limited between these two. Fine. Okay. Now, why I'm introducing you to this function? In fact, I'll introduce you to their inverses as well. Okay, this is very important because many a times we'll use our online calculators to solve something. And you'll see that answer they give will be in terms of, you know, sometimes in terms of hyperbolic function. So you should not be surprised that, okay, what is this answer actually? So there is inverse of sine or shine, which is called sine hyperbolic inverse x. And it is given by ln x plus under root x square plus 1. People who have done integration to a slightly advanced level would know that they see this term later on. So we'll come across this term later on. I'm not sure whether we'll see this today or in the next class. Then there's something called cos hyperbolic inverse x, which is the same thing but with a minus sign here. And finally, tan hyperbolic inverse x, which is half ln 1 plus x by 1 minus x. Okay. Please note that the domain of this function will always be a value which is between minus 1 to 1. Because the range is between minus 1 to 1. So domain of the inverse. I have not done inverse of a function with you officially. But when we do that, you will understand that the range of a function is the domain of its inverse and vice versa. Okay. So now these concepts will be used in our some of the formulas which I am going to give you.
Sir, could you go back 1 minute?
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, sorry. This is what you wanted to see?
Yes, sir.
Done?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now there are three important integrals that, you know, normally when we integrate this, okay, many books you will see that the answer that they would write is this. In fact, all your, you know, school level books, all the JE books will write the answer like this. But don't be surprised if you see sine hyperbolic inverse x plus c given as the answer. It is because this term itself is sine hyperbolic inverse x. So you may use some, you know, online calculators, Wolfram or some kind of, you know, calculator online. They may give you the final result like this. Okay. So it is just for your awareness. It is not like, you know, you have to know this. So normally the answer to this is given as ln mod x plus under root x square minus 1. But don't be surprised if you see cos hyperbolic inverse x given to you as the answer. And this integral is given as half ln 1 plus x by 1 minus x plus c. And don't feel surprised if at the back of the book they say tan hyperbolic inverse x plus c. Not your books, but probably it will be given in your online calculators. Okay. So this is just for your information. Now we are going to talk about the rules of integration. Hope you have copied this down. Any questions so far?
One second.
Shuva. Is that fine? Can we go on to the next page? Aditya? Okay, so now remember when we did differentiation, we followed it up with the methods of differentiation or the rules. It's like when you know how to drive a car, you should also now obey the traffic rules. So they are the rules of integration that we are going to learn. In fact, there are many, many rules for different types of questions, but these are the broad level rules that you must follow. Some of the rules I will introduce only when the time comes. Okay. If you're integrating a function f of x multiplied to a constant, you can bring the constant outside and multiply it to the result. Okay. And of course, put a constant of integration, which anyways will come from this process. Okay. So for example, if I'm integrating cos of 2 cos of x, it is just like integrating 2 times cos of x. So constant can be pulled out and you can write this as 2 sin x, okay, plus c. Now, another question that people ask me, sir, do we have to write c in the bracket of 2? That means, do we write 2c here? No, not required. 2c, c, log c, e to the power c, everything is just c. Okay. I don't know what you guys are thinking right now. Okay. So whatever is the C, okay, don't put any kind of, just keep it as C, nothing else. Okay. Secondly, when you're integrating, the sum or difference of, you know, multiple functions, it is as good as adding or subtracting their respective integrals. Okay. And just put one C at the end. Don't put C for this separately, and don't add it for God's sake. Okay. Just one C at the end of the solution is sufficient. Okay. Other than this, if you feel that there is a rule like this, okay, you know why I'm writing this in red? Because such a rule does not exist. Okay. So if you feel there is some rule that you had done in differentiation and there's a rule similar to that in integration, I'm very, very sorry. There is no such rule like this. Right? So the product rule that you have learned in your differentiation chapter, that doesn't work in integration the same way. Okay. So avoid extrapolating any formula. Avoid extrapolating any formula means do not try to invent your own formula. Okay, that's one of the grave mistakes which people have been doing. So there is nothing like quotient rule as you have learned in your integration. There is nothing like this. Okay, so why I'm writing this is because I want to make you realize that such things do not exist. Don't even try them. Okay, there is no product rule. There is no quotient rule as you know them in differentiation. Yes, there is a rule called integration by parts. Okay. Though I'm giving you the formula right now, but do not use it until unless you have been officially taught this particular concept. So in today's class, I'll be giving you a lot of, you know, questions which will involve product of two functions, but do not use them. It is just like, you know, let me give you an analogy. It is like a nuclear weapon. You cannot use it to kill mosquitoes. Okay. Because it comes with lot of, you can say, negative things. Okay. What do you call that in medicine terms? Lot of?
Side effects.
How can I miss that word? Yeah. It comes with lot of side effects. The side effect is you may end up integrating, you know, which is integrating something which will go on and on forever. Okay. So don't misuse this. Okay. Even though I'm giving you the formula, don't misuse it. The formula says, if you're integrating product of two functions, it is given as f integral g minus integral of derivative of f into integral of g whole integral. Okay. Again, as of now, be blind about this formula. We'll talk about it later. Okay. When I deal with this topic, Now, how do we choose F and G? That everything will be told to you later on. As of now, just ignore this formula. Okay. The next rule that we are going to discuss is something which we call as the reverse chain rule. Reverse chain rule. Okay. Short form RCR. What is the reverse chain rule? It says that if the integral of any function is g of x plus c, okay, then if you are changing your input of x by, let's say, ax plus b, that means you are linearly extending x to some ax plus b. For example, let's say you know how to integrate cos x. Let's say cos x integration, we know that it is sine of x plus c, right? If instead of cos x you were given cos 2x plus 3, then this formula will help you. So this gives you the same answer, but again x replaced with ax plus b divided by the coefficient of x.
Yeah.
Divided by the coefficient of x, which is a. Okay, very much similar to the chain rule which you had learned in differentiation. And that's why here we call it as reverse chain rule, because in chain rule you used to multiply that by that constant, isn't it? Here you are going to divide by that constant. I'll give you a simple example for this. Yes, any question, anybody?
Sir, if instead of a linear function, can a quadratic...
No. That's why I was very, stressing on the fact that it could only be a linear extension of x, no quadratic extension. Okay? Only linear extension it will work. So instead of x, if you have, let's say, x square plus 2x plus 5, sorry, this formula is not going to work. For that, you have to apply some other methodology. Okay. It is only for those minor changes where x has been replaced with some ax plus b form. So now we all know integration of secant square x, which is tan x plus c. So if I asked you what is the integration of secant square, let's say minus 3x plus 4. Okay. So for this, you can directly use your reverse chain rule and say it is going to be tan of minus 3x plus 4 divided by the coefficient of x over here, which is minus 3. Okay, just add a c at the end. That's it. Okay, this is called the reverse chain rule. Okay, other than that, yes, there are different types of algorithms that we follow for different varieties of questions. Okay, and we'll introduce to you when the time comes. So we'll start solving questions in this topic. So let me begin with the first question. Okay. So here comes the first question for you. For every question, I'll give you around 90 seconds because they're not worth more than that. Don't need to type out the answer. Just write done if you're done. Okay. So exactly after 90 seconds, we'll discuss these questions. Probably some question will take you lesser also. Okay, so Dhyan says done. Sudha also, very good. Shankin done. Tripan also done. Okay. All right, so let's discuss it, dear students. Since we do not know any kind of a quotient rule, the only option that is left with us is to expand the numerator and manually divide manually divide each term by under root of x. Okay. So when I do that, I get 1 by root x, 3 root x, 3x to the power 3 by 2, and x to the power 5 by 2. Okay. So as you know that from the rule of integration, we can individually evaluate their integrals and add them up. Okay. Now each of them will follow the power rule. So this is x to the power minus half. Correct. So x to the power minus half integral will be what? X to the power minus half plus 1 by minus half plus 1. Okay, don't put a C because C will put at the last. So this is going to become 2 x to the power half. Okay. Similarly, this will be 3. Integral of x to the power half will be x to the power half plus 1 divided by half plus 1. Okay. This term will become 3 into x to the power 3 by 2 plus 1 by 3 by 2 plus 1. And this will become x to the power 5 by 2 plus 1, which is 7 by 2 divided by 7 by 2. Okay. Just put a C at the end of the process. Okay. You may further simplify this and write it as 2 root x. This will be 2 x to the power 3 by 2. This will be 6 by 5 x to the power 5 by 2. And this will be 2 by 7 x to the power 7 by 2. Okay. First question, very simple. Any problem in doing it? Any questions here? Okay. Next question. Integral of 2 to the power x plus 1 minus 5 x to the power x minus 1 by 10 to the power x. Just type done once you're done. Good. It seems you people are practicing also integration on your own. Okay, very good. So same people are saying done again. Okay, Shristi, Aditya, very good. Nice. Okay, again, if you have to solve this, we can write the numerator as 2 into 2 to the power x minus 1 fifth into 5 to the power x. And individually divide by 10 to the power x, 10 to the power x. Okay, so this is what we are integrating. If you open this up, it becomes 2 integral of 1 by 5 to the power x. Okay, minus 1 fifth integral of half to the power x. And I've split this up as two separate integrals. Any questions here? Any doubts? Any question on conversion from this step to this step? Fine. Okay. Now the reason for doing so is because now I have converted it to integral of this form. So please recall, integral of a to the power x is given as a to the power x by ln a. Okay. Don't put a c and all. C should be put at the end. So two times this will be 1 fifth to the power x by ln 1 fifth or ln 1 fifth minus 1 fifth half to the power x by ln half. Okay, just put a c at the end. If you want to further give it a nice touch, you can say minus 2 into 5 to the power minus x by minus ln 5 and minus 1 fifth 2 to the power minus x by minus ln 2. Right, so it becomes 2 5 to the power minus x by ln 5 plus 2 to the power minus x by 5 ln 2. Okay, any questions here? Any doubt? So I'm again starting with very basic problems so that, you know, everybody is able to understand those basic rules. Next, secant square x times cosecant square x. Again, it's a request to all of you, do not use product, do not use integration by parts, IBP. Please do not use it right now. I'll tell you when is the right time to use it. Probably not in this class. I think next class we'll be talking about questions related to IBP. As of now, these can be solved without using IBP, without using integration by parts. Done? Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Aish, what is that X? Oh, Dhan has also written the answer. Thank you, Dhan. Very good. All right, let's discuss this. Minus one. No. This will give you a function of x only. Minus 1 and all will not come out to be the answer. If it is a minus 1, it will be c. Okay. Yeah. And I'll also try to like to remind all of you that don't miss out on a c. Okay. Now, this term, I could write it as cos square x into sine square x. Okay. So, what I'm going to do, I don't know any kind of a quotient rule, product rule. So, what I'm going to do is, see, that's what I said, you have to think laterally many times. It's an unconventional way of problem solving. Integration is one of the chapters where you have to run your mind like anything. You have to be a good observer. Now, this one you have on the numerator, I have broken it up as sine square plus cos square. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to individually divide the denominator, okay, both the terms. Okay. So sine square gone, cos square gone. So what I have done, I have converted it to secant square x plus cosecant square x. And thankfully, I am aware of integral of both of these expressions. So integration of secant square x is tan x. Integration of cosecant square x is minus of cot x. Okay. Don't forget to put a c. So this should be your answer. Tan x minus cot x plus a c. Is that fine? Any question anywhere? Please also let me know if I'm going a little fast. Okay. Again, Sankin, there could be so many approaches. Ultimately, the answer that you should get should simplify to what we have got. Right? Okay. Okay, so this question is x square plus cos square whole multiplied to cosec square. This is whole multiplied to, you can put a bracket here if you want. Okay, divided by 1 plus x square. Any progress, anybody?
So 1 minute.
Sure. Okay, Tristi is done. Very good, Tristi. Okay, Kirtana. We'll see, Kirtana, whether that's correct or not. Okay, so enough time has been allotted. Now here we have to do some manipulations. I see a 1 plus x square down and I see an x square over here. So obvious feeling that will come in my mind is, let's put it as x square plus 1 and subtract a 1. Okay, so basically I'll write it like this. So this is what I have done to this bracketed term. Okay, and of course outside we have cosecant square x waiting for us. Okay, whole divided by 1 plus x square. Now, if you see this term over here, this term is negative of sine square x. So I can write the entire expression as something of this nature. Correct? And multiply it with cosecant square x and divide it by 1 plus x square. So 1 plus x square I'll separately divide here. Okay, so this gets cancelled. Now when you open the bracket, you'll end up getting a cosecant square x, okay, let's have it separate, minus sine square cosec square will cancel themselves out and you'll be ending up with this expression. Okay, now these are two simple expressions which we can integrate. This is going to be minus of cot x and this is going to be minus of tan inverse x. Remember, we had done this particular integration in the formula list. Okay, so this finally becomes your answer for this. Any question here? Can I move on to the next one? Anybody who wants to copy something or ask something, please let me know. Okay. Let's do this one. Integral of 1 by 1 plus sine x. So all these questions, you must be realizing that with minor modification, you are able to convert or break the function into basic functions whose integral is already known to you. Done? Oh, very good, very good. Nice, everyone. Okay, people are giving the answer. Okay, so for this question, what you'll do is, the moment we see 1 plus sine x, an obvious feeling comes in our mind that let's multiply and divide with 1 minus sine x. Okay, this has been an, you know, very old process that we have been following since class 10th identities, trigonometric identities. So this breaks the given expression to this, right? And individually, when you divide it, 1 by cos square x and sine x by cos square x. Okay, that leads to secant square x. And this is nothing but tan x sec x. Again, these are two basic functions whose integral is known to us. So that's going to be tan x minus sec x plus c. So this is going to be your answer. Tan x minus sec x plus c. Aditya, I think sign mistake has happened. Okay, any question, any doubt, any concern? Okay, So these are like the warm-up questions that I would like you to attempt. They might come in your school exams or your UTs. Okay. Let's do this. Secx by Secx plus tan x. And there is the twin problem of this, which is tan x by tan x, secx plus tan x. So approach is the same. You don't have to worry about the approach. No, so same answer is not there. It is a twin problem, means a similar approach is there. Siddhartha, it's not the same answer. Similar approach is there for both. Oh, you're saying it's the same answer as the previous question. Okay. Yeah, because if you multiply with the cos x, it results into the same expression. Okay, an alternative way to do this is, okay, yes, you can convert it to sine and cos. The alternative way to do it is you multiply with secx minus tan x. When you do that, you end up seeing a 1 in the denominator. Okay, so this guy becomes a 1. So that ends up giving you the same expression. You are absolutely correct. Okay, and that is nothing but tan x minus secx plus c. Okay, if you have to solve this question, all you need to do is this is 1 minus secx by secx plus tan x. Okay, so instead of integrating this, you can choose to integrate this. Integration of x, 1 is x. Integration, this is just now we figured it out, tan x minus secx plus c. Okay. So don't be like, you know, confused to see this question instead of this. Next. These are all confidence boosters so that you know the basic process at least. Achha, one more thing I have observed from my experience, in fact, it was my own experience, that when you're practicing, at a certain stage, you will realize that, okay, after this, I can do the question. After this, I can do the question. I know how to do it after this. And you'll stop there. Okay. What will happen in due course? What will happen? You will start forgetting your basic formulas. So for the initial 1 month, while you're practicing integration chapter, please take your problem to completion. Until unless you write that plus C, don't stop anywhere. Don't think that, okay, after this, I'll be able to do it. Because while you are, you know, doing the problem completely, you are also recalling all the formulas that you have learned. Okay, so you're building your muscle memory. Done. Very good. Okay, so in order to solve this, try to convert numerator in terms of the denominator. So I can see 4x plus 7 under the root symbol, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write 8x plus 13 as twice 4x plus 7 minus 1. Okay. Right? Now, individually, this term and this term, I'm going to divide by the denominator. So when I'm going to divide, first of all, I will get an under root of 4x plus 7 from here. And let me separate out the integral also. I don't want to keep it in the same. Okay. Now, both are basically cases of reverse chain rule. Okay. So this is like a extended linear extension of under root x. This is a linear extension of x to the power minus half. Okay, so recall reverse chain rule. So the answer here would be 4x plus 7 to the power of 3 by 2 divided by 3 by 2 but also divided by 4. This is very important. Okay, here 4x plus 7 and it's minus half plus 1 by minus half plus 1 but also divided by 4. Are you getting this point? So don't forget to divide by 4 in this case. So here you can see it's 1/3 of 4x plus 7 to the power of 3 by 2. Okay. And this is going to be minus half under root of 4x plus 7. So this is going to be the answer for this. Any questions here? Any questions? Okay. Let me know if you want some time to copy things, because I'm just rushing through it. Sine cube x. Now don't start extrapolating any formulae. When I say extrapolating means, if you think integration of sine x is minus cos x, so integration of sine cube x will be minus cos x the whole cube plus c, it doesn't work like that. Sorry. Do not invent your own formulae. Work strictly according to the standard integrals or the basic rules that you know. I have not given any such rule which will make you cube the result if there's a cube of the integrand. Okay, Aditya. Okay, Pratham, nice, good. Ariman, I really doubt. No, that's not correct, Ariman. Okay, let me take this up quickly. Now, nothing to worry. We already know that we have a multiple angle formula to help us out over here. Sine cube appears in the formula of sine 3x. Now, why I'm taking the help of this formula is because, let me tell you, boys and girls, it's easy to integrate trigonometric ratio of a multiple angle. Whereas it is not easy or it is difficult to integrate a trigonometric ratio raised to a higher power. So what we do, we always convert a higher power to a multiple angle, because converting it to multiple angle will just require the use of reverse chain rule. So in the same effort, I'm going to convert sine cube x as 3 sine x minus sine 3x whole divided by 4. Okay. So here where your trigonometric ratios identities will come into your action. So instead of integrating sine cube, I can integrate this entire expression. Since 1 by 4 is a constant, I'm keeping it outside the integral. Okay. Now you can easily integrate them. Integration of sine x is minus cos x. Integration of this will be cos 3x by 3. Okay, just put a c. If you want, you can put your term separately also. Minus 3 by 4 cos x and plus cos of 3x by 12. Okay, this is going to be your answer. One more confusion you will face in your problem solving. Unknowingly also your hand will write integration of sine x as cos x and integration of cos x as minus sine x, because you're so used to writing the derivative of those terms. So be conscious about those terms. Okay. Don't mess up with the sign. Wait. I have not taught substitution yet, Aditya. Wait. I have never mentioned any word like substitution so far. Okay, but I'm soon going to do it. Don't worry. As of now, whatever resources we have, we are dealing with those resources only. Okay, just the basic rules and reverse chain rule, all those stuff. Substitution, I'm going to take up immediately after this question. In fact, more questions we'll take. One more, then we'll take substitutions. Okay, Aditi, you want me to go to the 13th slide. Okay, so everybody, I'm assuming that you have copied this question on your notebooks. Okay, I'm just going to the 13th slide as of now. Yeah, Aditi, this is the 13th slide. Do you have any questions on this? I just wanted to copy it. Okay. All right, again, since we don't know any kind of a product rule and all, in fact, even if I know, I will not apply it to this. Because as I've told you, that's like a nuclear weapon. Don't start misusing it. When you can break an egg with a spoon, why to pick up a hammer? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to use my identity of 2 sine a sine b. Okay, what is that? Cos of a minus b minus cos a plus b. Okay, so this term sine 2x sine 3x, I could write it as half cos x minus cos 5x. So instead of integrating it, I'll choose to integrate this fellow. So that will give me half integration of cos x is sine x, and this is sine 5x by 5. Okay, so that will give me half sine x minus 1/10 of sine 5x. Okay, any question here? Tripan, I think you made a sign mistake again. Check. Yeah, any questions here, anybody? What's wrong with this? All right, let's take up this question. So in the past 19 minutes, we have solved almost 10 questions. So that's a very good speed. Of course, there are various other methods also to do it, which we haven't yet learned. But whatever you know so far, that is sufficient to do this question. No clue, no idea. Anybody? Anybody has any idea how to do this?
So one dot root. So you one can write 2x minus 7 as a x minus 3 plus x minus 4.
Huh? Okay, let's look at this term which is within the under root sign, this quadratic term. Okay, if you multiply it, you see x square minus 7x. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to multiply this term with a 4. That means I'm going to make it as 4x square minus 28x plus 48. Now, if you are a good observer, you would observe that this is nothing but 2x minus 7 the whole square minus 1. Do you realize that? The same 2x minus 7 which is present over here also, right? So this is what exactly I'm going to do. I'm going to multiply a 4 inside the root. That means to in order to compensate that, I must have a 2 on the numerator, okay? And inside I'm going to write it as 2x minus 7 the whole square minus 1, okay? If you want, you can keep this 2 outside the purview, right? Now, doesn't it remind you of the integral of x under root x square minus 1? Is it where the x role is being now played by 2x minus 7? Correct? Yes or no? So the answer to this, we can directly write 2 sec inverse 2x minus 7. But don't forget to divide by a 2 because this is a linear extension of x. So 2 and 2 will get cancelled. So just put a C. This is what your answer is going to be. Okay. Let me see if anyone realized that. Oh yeah, Kirtana realized that. Very good, Kirtana. Okay. So you have to be a good observer in that case. Now moving on to another important rule, which is called the method of substitution. In fact, it's not a rule. It's an algorithm or a method. Okay. This is what Aditya was talking about a couple of minutes ago. Method of substitution. I call this method as the heart and soul of integration. Heart and soul of integration. Because almost in 80% of the questions, you would need some kind of a substitution. Now, first of all, why do we need substitution? We need substitution to convert a complicated expression to a simpler integrand, or a, we need to convert it to a simpler form which we can easily integrate, right? Either to your basic formula or to your standard results that you will be seeing, you know, in due course. Okay, so the whole and sole aim for method of substitution is to convert your complex integrand to a simpler integrand whose integration is known to you. The second question arises, how do we do these substitutions? Now, there is no fixed method for it. It all depends on question to question. So for that, you have to be a very good observer. That is what makes this chapter very unconventional. There's no fixed rule that, okay, take this and substitute it. Okay. There are in few cases, but many a times you will only come to know them through a lot of practice. Okay, so practice and a good observation skill is going to sail you through this particular chapter. Okay, so I'm not going to give you any kind of a rule for how to substitute. Of course, in some cases I will give you, but not in every case, because there can be millions of problems framed and you have to think millions, you know, in a millions different way. Let me start with the integration of certain trigonometric terms which we haven't seen yet. So let's say if I want to integrate tan x, how will I integrate it? Okay. Now let me solve this for you so that you get an idea how do we do substitutions. So we know tan x could be written as sin x by cos x. Okay. Now when you see such a term, when you see such an expression, okay, you can see there is a sin x term sitting on the numerator and there's a cos x term sitting in the denominator. Okay. So let's say a student A, what he does, he substitutes cos x with t. Okay. When you substitute a function or a part of a function with t, or when you substitute your, any particular term with a t, please note, you have to convert the entire expression in terms of t. When I say entire expression, that means you also need to take care of this dx term also. I've seen in my past, many people do haphazard substitutions. That means they will substitute the function, but they will not substitute their dx. As a result, they are not doing mistakes, they are doing blunder. Everything will go for a toss. Okay. So please remember this, that whenever you are making a substitution in that integrand, not only the integrand, but dx also needs to be converted in terms of the new variable. And that's why it becomes so important not to miss out writing that dx. Because if you don't write that dx, you'll probably forget to replace it. Okay. So it's not only a matter of habit, it's a matter of compulsion that you need to write that dx. So once you do that, let me differentiate both sides with respect to x. So differentiation of cos x is minus sin x. Differentiation of t with respect to x is dt by dx. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to make the final, shuffling over here. So let me put the dx term on top here. Okay, what I can do is, since there is a sin x into dx term, I can directly obtain that from here itself in one shot as negative dt. So I'm going to make a replacement of the numerator with a negative dt. Denominator is of course a t. Yes or no? By doing such substitution, I converted it to a form whose integral is well known to me. Remember, we had done 1 by x. Don't worry about this minus sign. Minus sign can be always pulled out. So remember, we had done integration of 1 by x, which was ln mod x, correct? In the same way, the integration here will become minus ln mod t plus c, okay? Now, don't forget to put your variable back in terms of x, because t is something which you had introduced in the question. So when I put back the t, I get this. If I take a minus sign on top, it becomes ln sec x plus c. Okay, so going forward, please remember this result, because you're not going to derive this over and over again. Okay, see, I'm again repeating it. I broke it up as sine by cos into dx. Then Aditya, what I did, I replaced cos x with t. Okay, I differentiated both sides with respect to x. So I differentiated both sides with respect to x. Okay, I took the dx on the other side. Okay, sin x dx will become negative dt. So this becomes negative dt by t, which is negative ln mod t plus c. Okay, put your t back now as cos x. Okay, this minus sign comes as a power on it. So cos x to the power minus 1 is sec. So ln sec x plus c is the answer. Any questions here? Now let's say there's a student B, right, who thinks, let me substitute sin x as t. Okay, see, nothing will go wrong. It's just that his process might be elongated. So if you take sin x as t, okay, differentiate both sides, you get cos x. Okay, by the way, my dear students, let me tell you one thing here. Going forward, I'm not going to write this step. I'm going to directly jump from here to here. Okay. Is that fine? I'm not going to show you step by step how did I reach this. I'm directly going to reach this. Okay, any question with direct conversion from here to here? Okay. Now, when you're solving the question, sine x by cos x into dx, you need a cos x on top. So I can create a cos x by multiplying numerator and denominator with a cos x. Okay, so student B is taking this approach where he took sin x as t, then he realized cos x dx is coming dt, and there was no cos x on top, so he manually created a cos x by multiplying and dividing. This is called the manipulation. You need to learn this because you'll have to do this in subsequent concepts. Then what he did, this cos square that he got down, he converted that in terms of sine because he had substituted sin x as t. Now, replace your sin x with t, replace your cos x dx with dt, replace your denominator with 1 minus t square. Okay, but still he's in a fix because we don't know how to integrate this also. So what he will do next is he's again going to make one more substitution. He's going to make this as some other variable, let's say k. Okay, now differentiate both sides with respect to t. Okay, and bring this dt on top, even though I said I will not do it, but I'm doing it for the initial part of your learning. Okay, so I can say t dt, the term which is present over here, you could write it as minus half dk. Correct? So this entire expression becomes minus half dk by k. Now finally, student B realizes that he has something which he already knows how to integrate. So his result would be minus half ln mod k. But now he has to go back from k to t and from t to x. Now see how long the process has become, but he will end up getting the same result. Right? We know 1 minus sine square is cos square. Okay? And if you raise cos square to minus half power, it becomes ln sec x. So ultimately the same answer he gets, but with multiple substitutions. Okay. So why I told you the method B approach of student B is because if you choose up taking a wrong function also as t, you may end up getting the answer, but it's just that the process will be elongated. It will be a prolonged process. Is that fine? Is this example helping you to understand how method of substitution works? Now, I would request all of you now to integrate in the similar way, cot of x. Try this out.
Sir, we can use this method for any problem or...
There is no rule like that. You can use it for any problem. Where it is required, you have to use it. It's like trigonometric identities.
So with for the previous problems you gave, we can use it like it won't...
You can use it. It won't go wrong, provided it gives you an opportunity to use it. Don't start using it for every, Tom, Dick and Harry. Okay. Is that fine, Ananya? Any question?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So here, I'm sure most of you would have figured out that you could write it like this. And by observation, you can see that if you take sin x as t, cos x dx will behave as your dt. Okay. So the next step is taking sin x as t. As I told you, I would directly jump to this step. Okay. So your numerator entirely will get replaced with dt. So it becomes dt by t. Again, it's a, integral which we know how to do it. Okay. So your answer will be ln mod sin x plus c. Please remember this result because please add this to your formula list because nobody is going to derive this separately in the examination hall. So why to waste time? Let me just cover up the integration of these left out trigonometric functions. So tan we have already seen, cot we have already seen. Let's talk about sec. Now in case of sec, again, you have to think out of the box. this will not help you out. This will not help you out. Okay. So people who are trying to convert it to 1 by cos x, remember, it will not help you out. There is another approach which again will come through a bit of practice for you. So in order to integrate this, what we do is we multiply and divide with secx plus tan x. Again, you will have to have this, you know, you can say foresight. Okay, vision. What are you going to achieve? See, when you do that, you realize you end up getting sec square x plus secx tan x dx on top. And in the denominator, you have secx plus tan x. And you can see that this is the derivative of tan and this is the derivative of sec, right? So this will actually help you to substitute secx plus tan as another variable t, correct? So when you differentiate both sides, automatically the term on the numerator will surface up. So as you can see, this term is already sitting on your numerator, isn't it? So that term can be replaced conveniently with a dt. And denominator, as we have already taken it to be t. Again, it comes out to be 1 by t. So many of you would be thinking every time it comes out to be 1 by t. No, not every time. But yes, in most of the cases, you'll see that it gets converted to such kind of expressions. Okay. This is basically actually covered under, I'll tell you after I complete this question. So it is going to be ln mod t plus c. And put your t back. Your t was secx plus tan x. Okay. Now let's say you are solving this problem and you turn your book back and see that the book has given the answer as ln tan pi by 4 plus x by 2. Now don't be surprised if you see this. Okay, don't start doubting your, you know, integration process. It is because the book probably has used a simplification of this term. Okay, now I would like all of you to, you know, realize this on your own. If you simplify secx plus tan x, okay, we can write it as, if I'm not wrong, we can write it like this, correct? And 1 plus sin x, we can write it as cos x by 2 plus sin x by 2 the whole square. I'm sure you are familiar with 1 plus sin x being broken up like this. And cos x could be written as cos x square by 2 minus sin square x by 2. Okay. If you split this up into two factors in the denominator, you will end up getting a minus b, a plus b formula. Okay. This and this gets cancelled. Okay. In the remaining term, you can substitute your or you can divide throughout with cos x by 2. So that will give you 1 plus tan x by 2 by 1 minus tan x by 2. Correct? So what I did, the term which was remaining, that is this term, I divided my numerator and denominator by cos x by 2. Okay? And this clearly is the formula of tan pi by 4 plus x by 2. That's what you see over here. Okay. So don't be surprised if you see this formula at the back of your book. It is one and the same thing. Sometimes they will also write it as ln secx minus tan x. Okay. Do I need to tell you why? Do I need to tell you why they can write this term as this?
1 by secx minus
tan x. Yeah, it is. Secx plus tan x is 1 by secx minus tan x. That's why. Is this fine? So this is a term which probably needs a different approach altogether. Of course, you are using substitution only, but only after doing certain manipulations. So be ready with these manipulations. And it may not come, you know, very naturally to most of us. In the same way, hope you don't have anything to copy in this. Can I move on to the next slide? In the same way, if you want to integrate cosec x with respect to x, we have a similar approach. We multiply and divide it with cosec x minus cot x. Why do we do that? Is because the moment you take cosec x minus cot x as your t, you realize that the derivative of this, okay, I'm just writing down the derivative of these terms. So cosec x derivative is minus cosec x cot x, and minus cot x derivative is cosecant square x. So this into dx is dt. And this term is already sitting on the numerator. Check it out. So if you open the brackets, you end up getting this curly bracketed term. Correct? That means you are again ending up integrating dt by t. So which will give you ln mod t plus c, which is nothing but ln mod cosec x minus cot x plus c. Please remember this formula, very important. And don't be surprised if you see ln tan x by 2 also in your answer. Both mean the same. You just have to reduce this. Now, how to reduce it? I'll leave it up for you as homework. Okay. And don't be surprised even if you see negative ln cosec x plus cot x plus c. So all of them will give you the same thing. So they're all the same things. Is that fine? Any questions here? So now in your formula list, you have added integration of tan x, cot x, sec x, cosec x as well. And thanks to method of substitution by which we could do that. So in your mind, please, you know, recall all these formulas. Integration of tan x, close your eyes, everybody. Think, integration of tan x, ln mod sec x plus c. Okay, done. Integration of cot x, ln mod sin x plus c. Done. Integration of sec x, ln mod sec x plus tan x plus c. You can also remember it as ln mod tan pi by 4 plus x by 2 plus c. Done. Integration of cosec x is ln mod cosec x minus cot x. So remember, there is a minus here. In sec 1, there was a positive. So ln mod cosec x minus cot x plus c. You can also remember it as ln tan x by 2 plus c. Okay. As of now, scribble it down somewhere because you would definitely need it in problem solving. So let us start solving questions on method of substitution other than what we have done. So let me take up a problem with you. Okay, let's take this up. Done? Very good. So here you have to be a very good observer. If you see this guy, it is 1 minus 1 by x square. Correct? This actually comes as a derivative of x plus 1 by x. Right? And both of these terms are present. Now this is an indication to you that we have to take this as t. Right? Isn't it? So you have to observe from the given expression what all could be substituted and what all will behave as, you know, the derivative of that. It may be present in the question itself, or you may have to manually do some kind of tweaking with the question to generate that. Okay, that's why this topic is very unconventional. So you can see that 1 minus 1 by x square dx, this entire term will behave as a dt. So this whole question gets converted to integral of t to the power 3 by 2 dt. Correct? Yes or no? So that will become t to the power 5 by 2 divided by 5 by 2 plus a c. And put your t back. You are done. This is the answer. Okay, does it make sense? Correct, Shishti, Pratham, very good. Vibhav, just check your working. Okay, let's take one more. Not one more, many more, sorry. Okay, let's take this one. Okay, simple. So here you can see that tan x derivative is secant square, which is present on the top. Okay. Now many a times people take tan x. If it is not wrong to take the whole thing also. You can take the whole thing also as t, because constant will anyways not matter to you. So if you differentiate both sides with respect to, you know, the respective variables, you end up getting something like this. And this term is already sitting proudly on the numerator. So that will be dt. And 3 plus tan x is t again. Okay, so once again, you can see ln has appeared. So your answer is ln mod 3 plus tan x plus t. Okay. So I think most of you are now feeling confident about, you know, how to substitute. Okay, we are going to take more examples. Try this one out. Integral of 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus x. Done?
4 minutes.
Now see here, if you just take this as 1 by e to the power x and write it properly, you would realize you'll end up getting this. Okay. And e to the power x is the derivative of e to the power x itself. So the obvious substitution that will come into your mind is, let's substitute this entire denominator as a t. So e to the power x dx will automatically behave as dt. So this entire term will behave as a dt. So again, it gets converted to dt by t form, which is ln mod t. And t is ln mod e to the power x plus 1 plus c. Okay. Very good. Let's take the another one. A and B here are constants, okay? A and B here are constants, and you're integrating with respect to x. Done. Okay. Now again, if you see by observation that from the past, you have seen that whenever you differentiated sine square x, we used to get 2 sine x cos x, isn't it? Which is nothing but sine of 2x. Okay. And whenever you differentiated cos square x, we ended up getting minus 2 sine x cos x, isn't it? Which is again minus sine 2x. So the derivative of these terms is resulting into sine of 2x. So what I'm going to do here is, in light of this observation, I'm going to put this entire thing as t. Okay. So if you differentiate both sides, you end up getting sine square 2x. The derivative of this will be minus b square sine 2x. Don't forget a dx over here, which was actually in the denominator of the right side, but I've pulled it over here. As I told you, I will not write it like, you know, this is equal to dt by dx. I'll directly jump to this step, which clearly says that if you take sine 2x common, okay, it gives you sine 2x dx as dt by a square minus b square. So this term that is sitting over here, okay, the one which I have shown with a yellow amoeba structure, I could replace that with dt by a square minus b square. So I end up getting dt by a square minus b square, which I'm keeping outside because it's a constant, and the denominator is a t. Okay, so this is what we end to get to integrate. So we can write this as 1 by a square minus b square. Okay, and this will become ln mod t plus c. Okay, so replace your t back, and this is what you should see. This question is a potential question for you in your school exams. So please mark it with a star and keep. This may be asked in your school exam. Is that fine? Any questions? Okay. Let's take this question. Okay, so ln of tan x by 2 by sin x. Yes, any idea how to do this?
Sir, take ln tan x by 2 as.
Right, so for a change now, here you will take a numerator term to be t. So this is a, you know, trend breaker. Many of us, we feel that only the denominator terms can be taken as t, and the derivative will always be there on the numerator. Don't be under that impression. Things may change. Okay. So if you take this as t, the derivative on both the sides, if you take with respect to x, you'll end up getting this into secant square x by 2 into half. This is going to be dt. Please don't forget into half. You are applying chain rule for differentiation. So this will give you 1 by 2. If I'm not mistaken, you'll end up getting sine x by 2 cos x by 2. Isn't it? So secant square x by 2 is cos square x by 2 will come on the top, and the cos of the denominator will get cancelled, thereby giving you dx by sin x as dt. Yes.
Sir, we already know that integral of cosec x is ln tan x by 2, right?
Yeah.
So we
very good. Very good. That's also a good idea to do it. So what he said, okay, let me complete this. So you can take this entire term dx by sin x as dt. So it becomes t dt. Correct? So your answer is half t square plus a c. That means half log tan x by 2 whole square plus c. Yes or no? Another important thing is, you know that integral of cosec x dx is ln tan x by 2. by fundamental principle or by fundamental theorem of calculus, we can say derivative of ln tan x by 2 is going to be cosec x, which means d ln tan x by 2 is going to be cosec x dx. Okay, so this entire term you can break it up like this: ln tan x by 2 and dx by sin x, which is cosec x dx, you can write it as d ln tan x by 2. That means you have written something like t dt over here. Okay, that will again become t square by 2 plus c, which is again square of ln tan x by 2 plus c. Very good. You can apply that method also to do it. Now I'm going to take a break over here. Okay, let's have a break of 15 minutes. Okay, we'll resume at 11:17 a.m. Okay. Any questions, please let me know. Take a break right now. All right, welcome back, everybody. So let's start with this question. I hope you can see the question here. You have to integrate dx by x square times x to the power 4 plus 1 to the power of 3 by 4. Okay, let's have 90 seconds for this as well. Please type done once you're done. Yes, any progress by anybody?
1 minute.
This could be a potential question for your school or board exams also. Okay, let me help you out with this. Just tell me one thing. What will happen if I take x to the power 4 common out from this particular bracket term? What will it come out as?
X cube.
Absolutely. And there's an x square already waiting outside. So can I say it will become x to the power 5? Inside the bracket, I'll end up seeing this. Okay. Now just try to relate this term with this term, and of course I can say that this term will appear or similar to this term will appear when you differentiate this term. Remember, 1 by x to the power 4, the derivative will generate something by x to the power 5. Of course a constant and all will come, that I can easily take care of. Don't worry about the constant. But what I'm trying to say here is that the derivative of this expression would result into such expressions which will contain x to the power 5 in the denominator. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to exactly do the same and take this as a t. Okay, differentiate both sides with respect to x, you'll end up getting minus 4x to the power 5 dx as dt. Right? In other words, dx by x to the power 5 is minus 1/4 dt. Right? So this whole term, let me just wipe out this bracket here. Okay, so this, let me remove this. Okay, so this whole term over here, that will behave as negative 1/4 dt. Okay, and this is t to the power of 3/4. So this entire integral gets converted to minus 1/4 dt by t to the power 3/4. Which is a subject matter of power rule of integration, which you can directly do. And this will give you the result as t to the power this plus 1 divided by this. So that gives you minus t to the power 1/4. That's nothing but negative 1 plus 1 by x to the power 4 to the power 1/4. That's done. Okay. So you have to do such kind of manipulations in order to get your work done. Okay. It'll only come with practice, practice, and nothing else. Okay. Let's take up this question. Evaluate integral of product of tan x, tan 2x, tan 3x. Very good, Siddhartha. Now, the problem here is that we can't integrate product of three functions. Okay. Even if we knew how to do them, we will not apply it at this present case. So what I'm going to do here is, this is just a hint for people who are trying it. This tan of 3x, try writing it as a compound angle here. Okay. Then see whether this is going to help you out or not. So I'm sure you would have made use of that hint. So what to do next? You just multiply this with this term. So when you expand it, I'm going to write it in short form. You can use this expression normally. I use short forms like this. Okay. For sine, I write S. For cos, I write C. For tan, I write a T. But don't do that. Don't do these all kind of things in your school exam. Okay. Now what I need here, I need tx, t2x, and t3x. Correct. So from here I can write it down as t3x minus t2x minus tx. Okay. So what you have done finally or eventually, you have converted product as sum or difference of tan terms. Okay, and this becomes quite easy for us to integrate. Okay, so let me write it in a complete form. So tan of 3x minus tan of 2x minus tan of x. So instead of integrating the product, you are choosing to integrate this because this is well within our reach. This is well within our knowledge. So integration of tan 3x will be ln mod sec 3x whole divided by 3. Minus ln sec 2x whole divided by 2. and integration of tan x is ln of sec x, just put a c. Okay, so this is going to be your final answer for this integral. Okay, another twin of this is where you have tan 2x, tan 3x and tan 5x, right? In fact, in all the problems where you have the sum of the two equal to the third, you can apply the same approach. Right? Is that fine? Any questions here? Next. Yeah, this problem is another important school level problem. And I'm 100% sure this will come in one of your exams, whether it's a UT or a semester exam or board exams, pre-board exams, it will come. How do you do this question? Try it out, everybody. I'm going to give you a minute to think on it. Done. Okay, Aditya. Yeah, that's the right approach, Aditya. Proceed with that. Okay, so I'll just tell you a hint how to do this type of question. So here you multiply and divide with sine of a minus b. Remember, a and b are like constants, so you can play with these constants as you feel like to our advantage. Okay, so first step is multiply with sine a minus b. Okay, now this approach is also used even if you had this integral 1 by cos x minus a cos x minus b. Okay, in short, when you have two similar terms, okay, let's say sine or cos, we normally multiply and divide with sine a minus b. Okay, now this I will give you as a homework. Try this out as a homework. Now what I'll do with the numerator sine a minus b, I'm going to write it as sine x minus b minus x minus a. Okay, now I don't want to write too much. What I'll do is I'll just write it in the short form. So 1 by sine a minus b integral. If you expand this, it becomes sine x minus b cos x minus a minus sine x minus a cos x minus b divided by sine x minus a sine x minus b. Okay, this is what we get. Now, individually, these two terms that we have over here divided by the denominator. Okay, so I think sine x minus b will get cancelled and you'll get cx minus a by s x minus a minus here you'll get cos x minus b divided by sine x minus b. Okay, so ultimately you end up seeing something like this: sine a minus b, cos and by sine will be cot. Okay, cot integration, we all know ln of sine x, so it becomes sine a minus b ln mod sine x minus a minus ln mod sine x minus b. We may combine the log as a single term by using our log properties. So your final answer should look like ln mod sine x minus a by sine x minus b. Okay, just put a c at the end and that's it. This is a sure shot question for your school exam. Any questions here? Any question, any concern? You want to copy something? Should I drag it up, drag it down? Anybody wants to copy? Okay, this is the main thing. Yeah. Okay, let's do a twin of this where you have one as a sine and other as a cos. Okay, let's see whether you're able to apply it. Now here, just a quick hint, you have to multiply and divide with cos a minus b. Try it out. Similar approach. Okay, so quickly doing this, in fact, I'm also doing along with you. Okay. Sine x minus a, cos x minus b. Okay. So this can be expanded as cos x minus b, cos x minus a, plus sine x minus b, sine x minus a. By sine x minus a cos x minus b. So if I'm not mistaken, it'll give you cos x minus a by sine x minus a plus this will give you sine x minus b by cos x minus b. Correct? Okay. Let me know if I have missed out anything. So this is eventually 1 by cos of a minus b integral of cot x minus a plus tan x minus b. right? And we very well know how to integrate them. It becomes 1 by cos a minus b. This will become ln mod sine x minus a. This will become ln sec x minus a, but you can write it as 1 by cos x minus b. I'm doing this because I want to club these ln terms. So on clubbing them, this is the final result that you must all get by cos x minus b. Okay, very good, Dhyan, very good. Absolutely correct answer. Is this fine? Any questions here, please let me know. Okay. Let's take the next question. Let's take this one. Two to the power x into two to the power x. Any idea, anybody?
So, Jason, first term is T.
Absolutely, absolutely. The first term itself as T will work wonders for you. Okay? Because when you differentiate it by using chain rule, other terms will automatically surface out. That's very good. So, if you differentiate this with respect to X, we all have seen that 2 to the power anything derivative is 2 to the power same thing, ln 2. And again, that something is differentiated. Now, this is your something. So the derivative of this will be again 2 to the power that into ln 2. Again, this derivative of this term, which is again 2 to the power x ln 2. And this is going to be your final, you know, derivative of the left hand side. So you can see clearly that ln 2 whole cube and the very same expression that you are integrating is basically coming up. Yes or no? Which means this entire term which is present in the question could be written as dt by ln 2 whole cube. So ultimately, when you are integrating this with respect to x, you are actually integrating this with respect to t. Okay. So the answer will be t by ln 2 whole cube plus a c. So answer will be 2 to the power x into 2 to the power x by ln 2 whole cube plus c. Now this type of problem can come in various shape. They can put 5 to the power x. Approach is the same for all those cases. Okay. Now next I'm going to tell you certain useful. Yes.
Excuse me, sir. So in the previous question, isn't our t just 2 to the power x.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Did I write everything?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I'm so sorry. This is just 2 to the power. Yeah. Thanks, Shomik. By mistake, in the flow of speaking, I wrote everything. Sorry. So this is just T by this term. Correct. Okay. Now we are going to talk about certain useful trigonometric substitutions. Certain useful trigonometric substitutions. Okay. You may require this substitution even in your derivatives chapter. Okay, so please listen to this very, very carefully. Whenever you have an expression like this present in your integrand, okay, expression like this means it can be in the various forms of the same thing. For example, it could be root of this. It could be, let's say, a square plus x square to the power of 5/2. In many of these cases, you would realize that such substitution prove very, very handy. Substituting x as a tan theta or substituting it as a cot theta. Why it is very handy is because it converts this to a single trigonometric expression. So the moment you put x as a tan theta, it will convert it to a square sec square theta. Similarly for cot, it will convert it to a square cosec square theta. So it's easy to deal with those, you know, expressions in the present shape. If you have terms of the form a square minus x square or any term related to it, then x equal to a sine theta or x is equal to a cos theta proves very helpful. Okay. In a similar way, any expression related to x square minus a square, then x is equal to a sec theta or x is equal to a cosec theta helps very, very much in this case. So it proves very, very helpful. If you have under root of a minus x by a plus x, or you can say reciprocal of this, okay, in such cases x equal to a cos 2 theta is very, very beneficial. Now these substitutions are not only limited to this particular integration chapter. You can use it anywhere you feel it is required. Okay. If you see x minus a by b minus x, or if you see x minus a times b minus x. Okay. Then x equal to a cos square theta plus b sine square theta proves very, very helpful. Is that fine? We'll take a few questions where you would realize that such substitution is making our life very, very easy. Okay. Let's go on to a question based on this.
We go back.
Sorry, you want me to go back?
Yes, sir.
Just let me put the question. Then we can take back. Okay, let's take this one. People, please note this question down. We'll go back to the, I'm going back to the previous slide. Okay, yeah. So I'm going back to the previous slide, those who want to copy. Let me know once you're done.
Yes, sir, done.
One more thing I would like to highlight here, that the substitution which I gave you were the essential ones. It is not an exhaustive list. Okay. I mean, okay, after doing this problem, I'll give you more such cases. But it actually depends upon how you perceive the problem. Now, in this case, anybody has an idea how to do it? Any response, anybody?
Sir, we can complete the square, I think, in the denominator.
Yeah, then put x plus 1 is equal to 8 and theta, and then differentiate.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. So as you can see in the denominator, you can see x square plus 2x plus 2, right? So here we can say I can put x plus 1 as 1 tan theta, or you can say tan theta. Correct? That means dx would become secant square theta d theta. So what I'm going to do is this 1 into dx, I'm just going to replace it with secant square theta d theta. And this will become 1 plus tan square theta the whole square. 1 plus tan square theta the whole square. Which actually gives you, if I'm not mistaken, cos square theta. Because this also becomes secant square. Secant square square will become secant to the power 4. And one of the secant square will get cancelled. And this you can easily convert into double angles. Like this. And integrate it. So that will give you theta plus sine 2 theta by 2. Plus c. Here a bit of challenge you may feel in converting it to x back. So let's convert it to x back. So now, from this expression, I can say theta is tan inverse of x plus 1. Okay. And not only that, we also know sine of 2 theta is 2 tan theta by 1 plus tan square theta. Correct? So for this expression, I can write it as 1 fourth into 2 tan theta by 1 plus tan square theta. Right? This also I'll replace it. Tan inverse of x plus 1. So your final answer would look like this. Half tan inverse of x plus 1 plus half x plus 1 by x square plus 2x plus 2. Any questions here? Okay. I'm now going briefly to the previous slide where I would like to give you... Oh, sorry. I already pressed the button. Yeah. Can I go back to the previous question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Not question. Basically, I would like to complete the list by giving you few more conversions. But my discretion is, see, when I was learning this chapter, we were never taught about these conversions. But nowadays, I've seen it's a world of ready-made formulae. We were mostly left to our own to think about these substitutions. So I'll complete the list with few more. So let's say when you see these kind of terms, okay, or let's say this type of terms. We preferably substitute x as a tan square theta. Or x is equal to a cot square theta. Okay. If you see these terms, x by, or you can say under root of x by a minus x, or let's say reciprocal of this, or let's say this, or let's say reciprocal of this. We prefer substituting x as a sine square theta or a cos square theta. Okay. Any questions here? On the other hand, if you have terms like this, under root x by x minus a, or under root of x minus a by x, or under root of xx minus a, or under root of, you can say 1 by under root of xx minus a. In such cases, we prefer substituting x as a secant square theta or a cosecant square theta. Okay. And again, even if I have given you all these expansions, probably you have to exercise your own discretion while solving questions. Okay, what substitution will fit the best? And it's not necessary that you have to use substitution to solve questions. Let's take a few more questions on substitutions. This we already did. Okay, let's try this one. This is an NCRT question. 1 by x to the power half plus x to the power 1/3. Yes, any idea what to do? Any substitution that comes in your mind? Anybody?
No, 1 minute.
Yeah, sure. Okay, hint for you all. Substitute x with such a term which has a power of LCM of 2 and 3. That means substitute it with t to the power 6. Okay, this 6 is basically the LCM of 2 and 3. Okay, correct, Aditya. So, what is the benefit of doing so? When you replace your dx, it will be replaced with 6t to the power 5 dt. So you'll end up seeing something of this nature. Okay. T square term you can simply cancel out from the numerator and denominator. leaving you with this. Right? No doubt so far? Okay. Now, either you perform a long division, that means you divide your t cube by t plus 1, okay? Or you can do some kind of manipulations here. If I were you, I would do just this, okay? In the numerator and divide it separately by t plus 1, okay? So, t cube plus 1 is factorizable as t plus 1, t square minus t plus 1. Okay. And if you just cancel out this term, it will leave you with 6 times integral of t square minus, sorry for missing out dt. Let me write dt over here. Again, it's a matter of habit. If you start forgetting it, you'll keep, you know, that habit will stay with you even if you are attempting your school papers. Okay. So it will be 6 times t cube by 3 minus t square by 2 plus t minus ln of mod t plus 1. Okay. Put your t back. T is 6th root of x. So this will become 1/3 x to the power half. This will become half x to the power 1/3. T will become x to the power 1 by 6 minus ln mod x to the power 1 by 6 plus 1. Okay, you may open the brackets and multiply with 6 throughout. So that becomes your final answer. Is it fine? So again, this is a learning for you that whenever such kind of a terms are there, we normally put x as t to the power, the LCM of the denominators of these powers. Okay. Let's try some few difficult ones also. Yeah, let's try this one. So in such questions, all you can do is take a leap of faith, okay? Because it doesn't give you, observation may not be, you know, very helpful to you. So all you can do is take a leap of faith. So if I have to do anything with this problem, I would first try attempting this step. So let's say this is
try to make it tan. Can we try to make sec x plus cos x as in the form of tan x, or because tan inverse of tan x will become x? No, sir.
Okay, as of now, yes, but not always. Okay, will that help you in some case? So how will you generate the other terms? That is what is the question. Okay. Probably you may try taking sine cos x as t or something. correct? Yes or no? That's what you are trying to take. But then there will be an x term, whatever you are planning to get over here, that will be unaddressed. So as a leap of faith, let us try taking this. If things work out, that's fine. If it doesn't, we'll come back and change our approach. Okay. Now, what is the derivative of tan inverse something? We know it's 1 by that something's whole square. Okay. Into derivative of that something, that's going to be secx tan x, okay, minus sin x, okay, okay, like this, okay. Now let me simplify this even further. Let me write this as 1 by cos x plus cos x the whole square. And one more thing I'll do, I'll pull out a sine x from here. If I pull out a sine x, I'll end up getting 1 by cos square minus 1. Any questions? Let me take the LCM over here and let me just take the LCM here also. So cos, multiply throughout with cos square, that would be great. So cos square, this will also be cos square. Cos square will enter as a cos, so it will give you 1 plus cos square x the whole square. Okay. Here also, if you take the LCM, it will give you sin x 1 minus cos square x by cos square x. My God, it's becoming very, very huge. But thankfully, we are almost there. Cos square will go off. This is sin x into 1 minus cos square, which is again a sin square. So numerator will clearly become a sin cube, if I'm not mistaken. In the denominator, if you open the brackets, you get cos 4. You get 2 cos square and cos square, which is 3 cos square. And a 1. Now this is what is there in your numerator. Yeah, this term is what we have got. You can include this term also in your purview. Okay. So that whole term has actually become, the whole term has actually become a dt. So actually you're dealing with dt by t. Because this term was your t. This term was your t. Okay. So it worked in this case. Ln tan inverse secx plus cos x plus c will be your answer. Okay. And there's equally chance that it may not work. In those cases, we have to use higher level skills to solve it. That I'll keep on, you know, updating you as we go on. Any questions here? So you should not do any mistake in this application of chain rule while integrating it.
Could you go down?
Is that fine? Any questions? Okay. Let's try this out. Integration of e by x to the power x plus x by e to the power x whole multiplied with ln x. Try this out. Integration of e by x raised to the power x plus x by e raised to the power x whole multiplied with ln x. Okay, so nothing substantial is striking to us right now, other than taking a leap of faith of putting this term as t. Okay, let's try this out. If it works, then good and fine. Else we'll change our process. Try this out, everybody. Let me attempt it along with you. So first thing that you would do is take log to the base e on both the sides. So let me write it like this first. Okay. Let me differentiate with respect to x on both the sides. So this will give you, first I'm differentiating x, so 1 into this. Then I'm taking ln x by, sorry. Then x into derivative of this will be reciprocal into 1 by e. Okay, so this into dx is your 1 by t dt. Okay, now thankfully here ln x by e, we can write it as ln x minus ln e, and this itself is 1, and ln e and 1 will get cancelled out because ln e is also 1, so these two will get cancelled out, right? And you can see that ln x dx, which is there in their expression over here, can be expressed as dt by t. So this whole thing gets converted to, this is by the way 1 by t. This is t. And this you got wrote it as dt by t. Right? Which actually becomes a very easy problem to crack because it is just the integration of this, which is nothing but t minus 1 by t plus a c. So t is nothing but x by e to the power x. 1 by t is e by x to the power x plus a c. This becomes your answer. Right? So I'm exposing you to a slightly difficult versions of the same concept. Any question here? Any questions? Okay. Let's take few more as confidence boosting problems. This we have already done. Yeah, let's do this one. This I think you can do it in 30 seconds, not more than that. X squared times tan inverse of x cube by 1 plus x to the power 6. Anybody quickly tell me what substitution will you make here? Quick.
Tan inverse x cube root of t.
Absolutely. This is a no-brainer. Okay. So the derivative of this will be this into derivative of x cube. So chain rule, please do not miss out on that. So x squared dx by 1 plus x to the power 6 is 1/3 dt. So this guy is 1/3 dt, and this is t itself. So this is your integral. So let's not waste time and quickly write down the result. So your answer is 1/6 of tan inverse of x cube whole square plus c. Any questions? Now many people would prefer taking first x cube as t. You may do that, but you'll require one more substitution. So there are so many ways to approach. But if you're going to do other ways, you're going to just take longer to achieve the final answer.
One second.
Uh-oh. 1 second should have been said 1 second early. Yeah. Good enough?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Normally when too many boards are there, the software becomes slightly heavy and lagging. Let's try this one. Let's try this one. Quick, it's a 30 second problem, not even 30 seconds, 15 second problem. Yeah, there you go. Done. Pratham is done already. Very good. So you can see that this term that is sitting on the numerator, again, it requires a bit of, you know, good observation skills. If you differentiate this, you'll realize that the term that I have circled out on the numerator makes its appearance, which clearly indicates the fact that this choice is correct. Okay. So ultimately you see something like this in your question. That's nothing but integral of secant square t. That's nothing but tan of t plus c. So your answer will be tan of x e to the power x plus c. Done. Right? They may give it in different forms also. They may keep it in sine square, cos square, whatever. So you should be able to deal with it. The whole idea is this guy's derivative is sitting on the numerator. Any question here? Now I'm going towards another type of questions, another type of integrals, which is going to be heavily asked. The type is integrals involving integrants of this nature, sine to the power mx, cos to the power nx. Under this, there are various cases. Let me talk about the first case here. First case is the case where m and n belong to natural number, and let's say both are odd. Both m and n are odd. Okay. Let me give an example, then it will be good to explain it. Let's say I take sine to the power 3x, cos to the power 5x. Okay. Now you tell me, let's say this theory was not known to you. Let's say I have not even told you the theory actually. Let's say this question was given to you. How would you approach it? What would you substitute as your variable t? Any guesses? Anybody? Will you substitute sine x as t or cos x as t? Okay. To be very frank, any one of them will work. Okay. So you can solve this question by substituting sine x as equal to t or cos x equal to t also. Both of the approaches is going to work. Okay. But we follow our algorithm over here. We put that expression as t, which has a higher odd power. Okay. So put that trigonometric ratio as t that has a higher odd power. A higher odd power. Preferably. So as I told you, it can work even if you put, you know, the lower one also as t. Okay, I'll show you both the cases, then you take your call why I chose this approach. So right now, I decided to put cos x as t. Okay, so minus sine x dx will be dt. Right, that means sine x dx is negative dt. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to break this up as sine square x, and I'm going to pull out a sine x and give it along with x, along with dx. So sine cube, I broke it up as sine square into sine, sorry. And I clubbed it with dx so that I could substitute sine x dx with a negative dt. So this guy becomes negative dt. this guy becomes t to the power 5, undoubtedly. What will happen to this guy? 1 minus t square, correct. So I can say this entire integral converts to negative of t to the power 5, 1 minus t square. Okay. Basically, you are integrating t to the power 7 minus t to the power 5. That's again power rule of integration that you can easily answer. T to the power 8 by 8 minus t to the power 6 by 6 plus a c. And your t is cos of x. So this becomes your answer. Okay. Now, even if you substitute sin x as t, it will work, but slightly more, it will be longer, just slightly more. For example, if I take sin x as t, it will become cos x dx is equal to dt. So what I'm going to do is, from cos x, I'm going to carve out a cos to the power 5, I'm going to carve out a cos x. Okay. So this will be behaving as dt for you. This will be behaving as t cube for you. But this fellow will be behaving as 1 minus t square square. Okay. So slightly more time you'll take because you'll end up, you know, opening this bracket, again multiplying it with the term and then again integrating it. So this will be slightly longer. Okay. But the idea is you can substitute any one of them to be t and do your work. Okay. Any questions here? So case one is understood, no doubt about it. Okay. Let's talk about case two. Case two is a case where m and n are natural numbers and one of them is odd and the other is even. An example of this would be, let's say, sine to the power of, let's say, 4x into cos cube x. Okay. Now, let's say if you were given this problem, what would you like to substitute as t? Sine or cos?
Cos.
The idea is you should substitute sine x as t over here, the one with the even power. Okay. So the theory is substitute the trigonometric ratio with the even power as t. Okay. So if you put sin x as t, then cos x dx will become a dt. So borrow a cos x from here. So this will be like sine to the power 4x cos square x into cos x. So this will behave as dt. This will behave as 1 minus t square. And this will behave as t to the power 4. Okay. Now people who are saying who will substitute cos x as t. Remember when you borrow the sin x from here to make for your dt, you will be left with an odd power. Odd power means you will have to write it as 1 minus cos square to the power of 3 by 2. That will again create a trouble for you. Right. So hence this rule, please keep it in mind. Hence this rule. Okay. So with this, the problem will become a super easy question. That means you are integrating this. And I'm sure after this, you will be able to do it. Any question here? When one is odd, other is even. Case number three. When m and n are both natural numbers, or you can say it can be whole numbers also. Yeah, by the way, instead of natural numbers, you can put whole numbers everywhere. Okay. And m and n both are even. Both are even. Let me ask you a question. Let's say I want to integrate sine square x into cos to the power 4x. Okay, what will you do in this case? Now both are even. So even if you decide to substitute one as t, the other will be subjected to an odd power. and then using your trigonometric ratios will be difficult.
So can we substitute sine square x on st?
Sine square x st, okay. What will you achieve from there? You'll get sine 2x as your derivative.
That's nice.
Okay, now here, there are two approaches. One is by using your trigonometric double angle, or you can say multiple angle identities.
Sir?
Yes.
Can we convert that sine square x into cos square x, then apply, then substitute?
That's the problem, no. Even if you convert it to cos square, how would you deal with cos to the power 4 and cos to the power 6 and all? Are you getting my problem here? Problem here is I'm getting a higher power of sine or cos. How will I deal with that? Higher powers have to be converted to higher angles, or you can say multiple angles. Okay, that's the only way you can deal with it. So that's why the first approach says you can use your trigonometric multiple angle identities. And the second approach is basically the use of complex numbers. Okay. By the use of something which we call as the de Moivre's theorem. Okay. Now second approach. No. We can't use power rule on trig functions. That's the whole point. Never extrapolate these formulas. Didn't I tell you the other time? If sine x integration is known, sine cube, we cannot write, you know, we cannot extrapolate it. Those are only meant for linear functions. Okay. Now, out of this, the first approach is quite understandable. We'll do that first. And then we'll apply the second approach. But the second approach is not to be used for any school exams. Okay, this is just for your own, you know, for competitive exams, you can definitely use it. So let me first convert sine square x into cos to the power 4x as a multiple or a higher angles rather than higher powers. So the first thing that comes in your mind is converting sine square as 1 minus cos 2x by 2. Okay. Converting cos square as 1 plus cos 2x by 2 the whole square. Any questions here? Okay. Now let's take the constants outside. So 1 by 8. And not only that, 1 minus cos 2x and 1 of the 1 plus cos 2x will make 1 minus cos square 2x. Like this. Any doubt so far? Okay. Next, what I'm going to do is, this is sine square x. This guy is sine square x. Sine square 2x, sorry. Yeah. So this will become 1 minus cos 4x by 2. Okay. Which makes it 1/16. And you can multiply this 1 plus cos 2x minus cos 4x minus cos 4x cos 2x. See what I'm doing? Slowly and slowly, I'm converting it to multiple angles. Isn't it? Now here also, you can multiply and divide with a 2. Right? And use the formula of 2 cos A cos B. Okay, so that will be cos A minus B plus cos A plus B. Okay, right? You may further club sub terms if they are same. For example, minus half cos 2x and half cos 2x, you can make it plus half cos 2x, and you have minus cos 4x and minus half cos 6x. So with so much of effort, you have now converted this term over here as multiple angles. And not only that, you have converted the product as sum or difference. Correct? So instead of integrating this, you can choose to integrate this. Okay, and that will give you the answer as integration of 1 is x. Integration of this will be sine 2x by 2. Integration of this will be minus sine 4x by 4. Integration of this will be minus sine 6x by 12. Okay. If you want, you can take a factor of 4 out. You can make it 64. It becomes 4x. This will become 2 sine 2x. This will become sine 4x. And this will become minus sine 6x by 3 plus SA. Is this fine? So it requires a bit of effort from your side, and this is what you have to follow in school. Now, I'm sure you must be looking forward for the other method. So now I'm going to use the second method, which is the complex number method, through the use of de Moivre's theorem. Now, just a quick recap of what is de Moivre's theorem for those who were not there with us last year. De Moivre's theorem says that if there is a complex number like this, okay, and you raise it to the power of n, n being a integer, it gives you cos n theta plus I sine n theta. Okay, this is the de Moivre's theorem. Any question with respect to this? Okay, now I'm going to use this to solve this question. You must be wondering how. Okay, all of you please consider the following things. Let's say I call a complex number z to be cos x plus I sin x. Okay, so what will be 1 by z? Tell me, by the use of de Moivre's theorem, 1 by z means I'm raising it to the power of minus 1. Correct. Okay, if you add them, you'll end up getting cos x, 2 cos x is z plus 1 by z, isn't it? So cos x becomes half of z plus 1 by z. And if you subtract them, 2i sin x will become z minus 1 by z. So sin of x will become 1 by 2i z minus 1 by z. Any doubts so far? Now, for the first time that you're doing, we need to, you know, I need to show you all the steps. But let's say you are applying this to a question. You may directly substitute your cos x to be half z plus 1 by z and sine to be 1 by 2i z minus 1 by z. You don't have to undergo the same process. Okay. Now you must be wondering, why did I choose to write sine x and cos x like that? Let's see what is the benefit. So we had this term, right? If I'm not mistaken. So this term is 1 by 2i z minus 1 by z square. And cos x is 1 by 2 z plus 1 by z to the power of 4. Okay. If you collect all the constants, so here you will get minus 4, here you get 16. So minus 4 and 16 will be minus 1 by 64. Okay. And not only that, z minus 1 by z square and z plus 1 by z square will make z square minus 1 by z square square. And the remaining term will be like this. Let me know if you have not understood from this step to this step. Clear? Is it clear, everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you expand this, you are going to get Z4. 1 by z4 minus 2, z square 1 by z square plus 2. Okay, now I'm literally going to multiply these two terms. Okay, now while multiplying, some precautions have to be taken care. So first term with this will be z to the power 6. This into the second term will be z square. So write it separately, write it far. Okay, so this into this is z square, right? So I wrote it far. This into this will be 2z to the power 4. So 2z to the power 4, write it over here. Again, make some gap in between. Okay. Next is 1 by z to the power 4 with z square. That will give you 1 by z square. So club it with this. Okay. This with this will give you 1 by z to the power 6. So club it with the first term. Basically, you are clubbing it with the same term present in the numerator and same term in the reciprocal. Then this with this will give you 2 by z to the power 4. Okay. Next is minus 2 into z square will give you minus 2 z square. And this into this will give you minus 2 by z square. So what I can do is, I can just switch the sign over here with a minus. Okay. And minus 2 into minus 2 will be minus 4. Any doubt from this step to this step, please let me know. If you want, you can club this term together with a 2 outside. Any questions? Okay. If no questions at this stage, if everybody is happy, let me take you back again to De Moivre's theorem. Now, what will be z to the power 6 if z is this? You will say cos 6x plus I sin 6x. What will be 1 by z to the power 6? Okay. What will be the sum of these two? Do you agree? If you add these two, you will end up getting this. In a similar way, basically, you can substitute this guy as 2 cos 6x, this guy as 2 cos 4x, this guy as 2 cos 2x minus 4, and you are done. So you have converted it to a sum of multiple angles. So no need to undergo all these, you know, sine, cos, all those sums. Here you're dealing with pure single number z. Is this understood? Because after this, all you have to do is integrate. Any questions here? So just like z to the power 6 plus 1 by z to the power 6 became 2 cos 6x. In the same way, z to the power 4 plus 1 by z to the power 4 will become 2 cos 4x. In the same way, z square plus 1 by z square will become 2 cos 2x. And rest of the terms are just copy forward. Are you convinced with this? Any questions here? Okay. So once you have got this, the only thing left off for us is to integrate. So your final answer would look like this. So let's integrate this result. Integrate this. So your final answer will look like this. Integration of this will be 2 sine 6x by 6. This will be 4 sine 4x by 4. This will be minus 2 sine 2x by 2. And minus 4x. Okay. And if you want, you can check your answer is going to match with whatever we have got earlier. I'm just making some final touch-ups. This 2 and this 6, I'm making it as 3. Okay. This 4 and 4 gone off. Okay. Just match this answer. In fact, you can send the minus sign inside also. Okay. If you can send the minus sign inside, it will become minus here. Minus here. Plus here and plus here. Isn't this the same answer that you had got here also? Just check it out. This answer and this answer, check whether they are the same or not. And I'm giving you a few seconds to analyze this once again and ask any question if you have any. Good enough? Okay. So if this is fine, use De Moivre's theorem to integrate cos to the power 8x. Or do use complex numbers method to integrate cos to the power 8x. Now, in the first question, I told you so many things, but here you can directly jump with the fact that cos to the power 8x could be written as 1 by 2 z plus 1 by z to the power 8. Okay. What is 1 by 2 to the power 8? Correct? Z plus 1 by z to the power 8, see how will I write it? Z plus 1 by z to the power 8, how will I write it? See, first term is z to the power 8, last term will also be 1 by z to the power 8. So I'm clubbing them together. Okay. Second term will be 8c1 z to the power 6, and the second last term will also be 8 by z to the power 6. They'll automatically get clubbed up. You don't have to worry too much about clubbing them up. Next will be 8c2. What is 8c2? 28 z to the power 4, 1 by z to the power 4. Any questions? 8c2 is 8 into 7 by 2, right? That's 28. Then 8c3, 8 into 7 into 6 by 6, that is 56 z square plus 1 by z square. You must be wondering, where is z to the power 7 and 1 by z? They will not appear. They will not appear. Only the even ones will appear. And finally is your 8c4. 8c4 will be 8 into 7 into 6 into 5 by 24. So that will make it 70. Okay. Now the moment you have got this, you are done with the question actually, because that given expression could be written as, now this term is what? 2 cos 8x. Okay, so this term is 2 cos 8x. This is 2 cos 6x, but multiplied with the 2, it will become 16 cos 6x. This will become 56 cos 4x. This will become 112 cos 2x plus 70. And you are now ready to integrate. See how fast it was. If you apply your, you know, multiple angle by using your trigonometric ratios and identities, it will take you almost 5 times this time. Okay, so integrating cos to the power 8x is as good as integrating this. So which will give you 1 by 256, 2 sine 8x by 8, 16 sine 6x by 6, 56 sine 4x by 4, 112 sine 2x by 2, plus 70x. Is that fine? Any questions here? And you can finally, you know, cancel out the terms which you feel that they're, you know, for example, this can be made as 1 by 4. Okay. This can be made as 8 by 3. This can be made as 14, right? If I'm not wrong. And this is 56 like that. Is it fine? Any questions here? Okay. Let's go on to case number 4. Case number 4 is a case where your m and n are rational numbers, but however, they add up to give you a negative even integer. Okay, let's say minus k. Let's say minus k. Then how do you deal with this question? Let me give you an example. Let's say I want to integrate 1 by sine to the power. Five by 3x. And cos to the power 1 by 3x. As you can see here, the present problem is sine to the power minus 5 by 3 x cos to the power minus 1 by 3 x, right? So m is minus 5 by 3, n is minus 1 by 3. And if you add them, you'll end up getting, if you add these terms, you'll end up getting a negative even integer. Okay. So what is the approach here? What is the algorithm here? So when such a thing arises, we normally, number one, divide the numerator and denominator by cos to the power of kx, right? Remember your k is negative of m plus n. Okay, the same k here. Okay. And second thing is we put tan x as t. Is the approach clear? So what we do first, we divide the numerator and denominator by cos to the power kx, where k is negative of m plus n. And then we substitute tan x as t. Let's see what benefit it has for us. So let's divide here 1 by cos square x, and in the denominator also let us divide by cos square x. Okay, so this will give you secant square x on the top. Denominator, if you see, this 1/3 will get cancelled, leaving you with a 5/3, right? And sine 5/3 and cos 5/3 will become tan 5/3, something like this. And now it's a very obvious thing to proceed from here on with tan x as t. So if tan x is t, secant square x dx will become a dt. Okay, so it becomes a dt by t to the power 5/3, right? Which is nothing but an application of power rule of integration. So that is t to the power minus 2/3. Is that fine? So this is what is your answer. Any questions here, please ask.
So 1 minute.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay, no question, anybody? Okay. We'll do some more problem practice. I don't want to start with another type of thing at this point of time, because we just have 15 minutes of the class left. So we'll do some questions. Okay, let's take this question. This is an NCERT question. Let me know once you're done. Done? Okay, Shishti, very good. All right, this is not a big problem that you would be taking so much time. See, cos square x is what? 2 cos square x minus 1. Okay, now theta is a constant. Okay, so don't get scared of theta. But still, you can use 2 cos square theta minus 1 from it. Okay. Let the denominator be as such. when you open the brackets on top, you end up seeing cos square x minus cos square theta by cos x minus cos theta. Now it's obvious that your numerator can be factorized and one of the factors can get cancelled. So that will just leave you with cos x plus cos theta. Okay. So your answer will be just sin x. Cos theta is a constant, so just write x into that constant. That's it. Done. I think most of you would have started applying your transformation formula, right? But I think that should also work. Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah. I meant to integrate by x, but I wrote d theta by mistake. Sorry. Okay. If you had written d theta, then your cos x will become a constant. Try this one. Dx by under root of e to the power 5x. Fourth root of e to the power 2x plus e to the power minus 2x cube. So you may read this problem like this also, e to the power 5x by 2, e to the power 2x, e to the power minus 2x to the power of 3 by 4, 5x by 2. Yeah. Any success? Yeah. Okay, let's do one thing. From these two terms, let me take e to the power 2x out. Now, of course, it is subjected to 3/4 power, so it will come out as e to the power 3x by 2. Correct? Why did I write a 4 here? By mistake, I think. Okay. So inside here, you'll end up getting e to the power minus 4x raised to the power of 3 by 4. Okay. And if you observe that these two will collectively become e to the power 4x. So e to the power minus 4x will go. And in the denominator, you'll be left with e to the power minus 4x to the power of 3 by 4. Then I am sure you would know what to do next from here. Take this as t. So minus 4 e to the power minus 4x dx will become a dt. That means e to the power minus 4x dx will become minus 1/4 of dt. So this entire term, okay, will become minus 1/4 dt. So minus 1/4 dt, and this is t to the power minus 3 by 4. So your answer will be minus 1 by 4 t to the power minus 3 by 4 plus 1 will be 1 by 4 divided by 1 by 4. That gives you plus t. That gives you minus t. T is this term. Plus a C. Any questions? Try this one out. Integrate sine to the power minus 7 by 5x cos to the power minus 3 by 5x. The next class is going to be a very, very critical class because we are going to talk about various types of other standard integrals that exist, whose use is very extensive in problem solving. We'll also talk about integration by parts. We'll also talk about use of partial fractions for integration. We'll also talk about integrating irrational functions. Okay. If something is left, we'll take it in the third class. So the third class would be on more on integration by parts and on reduction formula. So three classes is definitely required. There may be a fourth one half required. After integration, which chapter do you want me to work with? Which chapter do you want, everybody, after integration?
Sir, you said you do ellipse and hyperbola again in the
Kripan, we'll do one thing. We'll keep this for some other day because right now when the school reopens, okay?
Yes, sir.
I want it to be at par with the school. At least matrices determinants is what you're doing right now, correct? Ellipse, hyperbola, you have done enough. You have just left with 5-10% towards the end, which is not very great. We can cover that up in any time you want. Okay, hardly take two classes. Okay. Okay. But what will happen if I don't start doing 12 syllabus? It will be like, too much will come at the end. And we have to start with the bridge crash course session in the month of November. So that remaining part will get enough time. Don't worry. So after integration, what do you want me to do?
Inverse trigonometry,
not matrices determinants. Or you think matrices determinants is easy? I can manage it. It's not easy chapter. It's a very, very critical chapter. Every year in JEE Main and JEE Advanced, two questions come from that particular chapter. Okay. Meanwhile, let's complete this. As you can see here, the sum of the powers is negative integer. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write it like this first. And I'm going to divide both numerator and denominator by cos square x. Okay. So that will give you a secant square x on top. And denominator, you can directly say it'll give you tan to the power 7 by 5x. For sure. Check it out. Okay. So put your tan x as t. So secant square x dx will become a dt. So this will become a dt by t to the power 7 by 5. So it's t to the power minus 7 by 5 dt. That's nothing but t to the power minus 2 by 5 divided by minus 2 by 5. So that will give you minus 5 by 2 tan x to the power of minus 2 by 5 plus c. Okay. So next class when we meet, we are going to talk about some more standard integrals. Okay, so next class agenda is standard, some standard integrals, basically the six types. In fact, I would suggest you to read them up and keep it. So 1 by x square plus a square type. You may all solve this by using substitution. So let me give this as a homework to you. All of you, for homework, you would prove the result of these integrals, which I'm going to give you next. So there are six integrals like this. All you need to do is your substitutions. Remember, I have told you some trigonometric substitutions. Apply them and do them. So please derive the results of these six integrals, which I am giving to you right now. This is 1 by a tan inverse x by a. This is 1 by 2a ln mod x minus a by x plus a. This is 1 by 2a. ln a plus x by a minus x, which is also called as 1 by a tan hyperbolic inverse x by a. Okay. This is ln x plus under root x square plus a square. Okay, which is sine hyperbolic inverse x by a also. This is ln x plus under root x square minus a square, which is cos hyperbolic inverse x by a. And finally, this is sine inverse x by a. So please prove them by use trigonometric substitutions. Is that fine? This is the homework for you for the next class. Okay, because we'll directly launch ourselves with this concept, so that will save a lot of time for us. Okay, never mind. Whatever we are supposed to do after this chapter, we'll discuss it in the last class. But I feel that we should start with what school is doing, because your UTs and all will come, and then you'll be like, you know, we have not covered the syllabus.
Sir, you do definite integration later, sir.
Definite integration after this?
Or will you do that separately?
What is going on in school? Siddhartha, what is going on in school?
Sir, we stopped at